himself at the feet of the Pope, he would be completely at his service. The Pope chartered him, and that Pope was Pius the Third. The Pope chartered him and created the Jesuit order. Now he has papal protection, and they begin their awful history of deeds of blood and war after war after war after war. They're all attributed to the Jesuit order in some way. Catholic nobles with lots of money donated castles and schools and money to the Jesuit order. Virtually everything they own has been given to them or stolen by them. Of course, they stole all the fortunes of the Jews in World War II. They stole the gold, all their assets, and everything whenever they went into a country. What is released is nothing compared to what they've taken. In Edmund Paris's book, printed Ozark Publications, called The Vatican Against Europe, it gets into great detail of what they did. It calls it the last 30 years of the war, and all attributable to the Jesuits, their massacres of the Serbs and the Jews, and etc. But Edmund Paris did not understand that the Jesuit general, and this one of the is one of the most important points I want to make about von Kolvenbach. The Jesuit general is in complete control of the international intelligence community. That's the CIA, the FBI, the KGB, the Israeli Mossad, the German BND, the British SIS. The Jesuit general is in complete control of the entire intelligence apparatus, FBI, every bureaucratic agency in this country, all of it. He is in complete control of it. So whenever he wants to find something out about an individual, they put it in their social security number. They put in their social security number, and everything from all the intelligence apparatus kicks in, and he and his provincials can review everything about that man. Credit cards, you name it. Everything that's attached to Rome, social security number, which FDR put upon us in 1933 with the help of Spellman at that time. I believe he was Archbishop, or maybe it was Cardinal Hayes, but Rome was behind FDR in putting him in office. The couple of things that he did was to implement social insecurity, the income tax, and recognize Joseph Stalin's bloody Jesuit USSR government. So with the giving of us the social security number, that the Rome's number, that's why I refuse to use it, and that's why they want everybody using it for everything, the driver's license, tax returns, credit cards, and everything. Everything you do, that's a number. That's the number in Rome's number. Martin, let me just back up here for a minute. What comes to mind is Louis Free, head of the FBI. Roman Catholic, good altar boy. Probably, this is Phelps, Roman Catholic, good altar boy, probably a Knight of Columbus. I can't prove it, but anybody with that kind of power has got to be a Knight of Columbus. And the Knights of Columbus implement Jesuit policies, Jesuit politics. And Louis Free was the one behind the Waco atrocity, the Oklahoma City bombing atrocity, and his top sniper was a Japanese Roman Catholic named Leon Horachai. So it's the Roman Catholics in control, Knights in control, the FBI, who carried out all of this killing. And this was two men, Louis Free, Leon Hordechai, all personally accountable to Cardinal O'Connor of New York. And Cardinal O'Connor of New York is the most powerful cardinal in the country. He is the military vicar, and that's why Bush kissed his family for going to Bob Jones, because Cardinal O'Connor is the king of the American Empire, and he rules the empire from the Palace St. Patrick's Cathedral, the Little Vatican, Martin. And is he in contact, do you think, with Kovenbach? Phelps, of course. O'Connor himself is not a Jesuit, but the Jesuits are like the SS or the Catholic Church. They maintain order. And the ones closest to him who maintain order are the Jesuits of Fordham University. Now, one of them, the head of Fordham University, I believe, he is an Irishman, is also a member of the CFR, Council of Foreign Relations, and I have that right here in the annual report of the CFR in 1993. These Jesuits of Fordham maintain semblance and rule over the Cardinal of New York. And of course, the powerful Jesuits of Fordham include Avery Dulles, Avery Dulles, and John Foster Dulles, one of the writers of the book on the Second Vatican Council. Martin, let's back up. Now let's go back. What's the Council of Trent? Phelps, the Council of Trent was the response of Rome to the Protestant Reformation. Remember, the Protestant Reformation brought us all the political liberty that we know today. There's no such thing as a national sovereignty without the Reformation. There's no such thing as private rights without Reformation. There's no such thing as the law of nations as we know it today. Montesquieu and others without the Reformation. And when the Reformation came from that doctrine, from their doctrine of salvation by grace through faith alone, and there was no need for the priesthood to go to heaven. That all we need is salvation of Christ, in Christ. Romans 1:17, the righteous shall live by faith. When the Reformation came, it completely stripped Rome of its spiritual power. The priests were no longer wanted because the people were getting the Word of God in a Bible, specifically in Holland, England, and Germany. And so, with these great revivals breaking forth and the Reformation happening, nations were breaking away from the power of the Pope. The Holy Roman Empire was breaking up. Charles V, the Emperor, reigned and became a monk and gardener. So the Lord was moving mightily in breaking the power of the Holy Roman Empire, and started with Chalmagni and the Pope. Well, that was not good for Rome, because they were losing lots of money. The nations were not paying Peter's pence. Anyone, which today we call foreign aid, and this country, and so the Pope was very upset about this. What's he going to do? There's nations. These nations are breaking away from us. They're not under our temporal or spiritual power. And it's very important to remember that the Pope claims two powers, spiritual and temporal. And with the breaking of his spiritual power, he then lost his temporal power. In other words, he no longer had the ability to rule that people through the king of the country, because the king was breaking away, like King VIII, like Henry VIII. So Henry VIII broke away from the Roman.